Yeah, we're continuing on with section number six here about meeting, you know, resident needs, basic nursing skills, measurements, and vital signs. So we're going to continue on with personal care. And again, I know I keep referring to your five-hour lab, but several of these things we will be going into more detail when you come here to Paola, and then, you know, talking about it as you're doing it as part of your refresher. So this part is the lecture part of it, okay? So when we're talking about personal care for the residents, the different things that we do for them, of course, is bathing. Now, there's different types of baths. There's a shower bath, there's the whirlpool bath, there's a partial bath. In all your baths, basically, the general rules are literally the same. You start with the eyes and face, and you end with the rectum. That's two cardinal rules. And when you clean the eyes, you start on the inside here with your washcloth and the single strokes to the outside. You don't want to bring stuff in the outer corner inside. There's a good possibility of giving somebody an eye infection that way. So you start with the eyes and face and basically end with the rectum, the perineal area, and then finally the rectum. And of course, when cleaning the rectum, you're going front to back. You're simply just not scrubbing back and forth, but you're going again single swipes front to back. If you were to go back and forth, there's the high probability you're going to introduce what's called E. coli into the urinary system, give the person a urinary tract infection. Now, the partial bed bath is just hands and face, underarms, and just basically perineal area. It's some people call it a spit bath. You know, it's a substitute. You know, a lot of times, you know, in between the regular baths and showers, it's just a quick wash up. A lot of people will talk about, well, when do you do the shampoo? You know, do you do it at the beginning of the bath? Do you do it at the end of the bath? Well, people that basically do it at the beginning of the bath have to realize the person sitting there during the whole rest of the bath with a wet head. Now, if you've been in a nursery at one of the hospitals lately, you've noticed that the little newborns are wearing like a stockinette cap on their head. The reason is because of body temperature loss. Well, are our elderly, are our frail elderly any less or more susceptible to the same thing as a newborn? No, they're just as frail. So if a newborn can lose body temperature this way, so can our frail elderly. So if the shampoo is given at the beginning of the shower, beginning of the bath, they're going to sit there during the whole thing with a wet head. Their body temperature is going to be going down. So best thing to do is do it at the end of the bath. You know, do the shampoo then, into the shower, so they're not sitting there with a wet head. You know, even for yourself, just do this as an experiment. Take a temperature before you take a bath or a shower, take it afterwards. You'll see that your body temperature has gone down, maybe a degree and a half. Well, if we add some more to that with our frail elderly, you could be seeing a seizure. You know, so it's safest to give them their shampoo, you know, at the end of the bath, in the shower. And we'll be doing the shower bath here, you know, simulated on a mannequin and basically talking about it during your lab time here, the bed bath, the shower bath. But like I said, this is when, you know, we basically have to watch the water temperature. We have to watch basically not getting the resident too cold, monitoring their dignity by keeping them covered during the shower. You know, could you imagine you being totally naked in front of a stranger with somebody bathing you? That would be humiliating. So if we need to think of ourselves in their situations, and you know, there'd be nothing wrong with washing a resident wearing their hospital gown. wow, what a novel idea, wash underneath it. Now, yes, there is some time during the bath when you have to look at the skin, because really, as a CNA, you are the only ones that are actually seeing the person's skin well to make a really complete assessment. So that's why a lot of nursing homes are going to have a shower sheet or a bath sheet or a skin sheet that you fill out should you see any cuts, scratches, any discolorations, anything like that, any edema or anything. So basically, when we're doing the bath, the order in which we do them, you know, wash the person is basically eyes, face, and ears, neck, arms, axilla, and hands, chest, abdomen, legs, feet, back, and then finally perineal area, and then last, basically buttocks. And with the bed bath, with the shower bath, with the tub bath, with whatever, we need to remember basically water temperature. We need to remember keeping them warm. We need to remember their dignity and keeping them covered. Now, for a partial bath or a bed bath, the no rinse soap is definitely the best to use, because a lot of times soap left on the skin will have a very drying effect. And their skin is already dry enough. The skin dries enough, it's going to crack. So if we accidentally leave soap on there, it's basically going to crack more. So the no rinse soap is basically our better deal. A lot of times I'll see CNAs that almost give what's called a lotion bath after the bath, to lotion up the person's skin and lubricate it and moisturize it, just to guard them a little bit more against the drying of the skin of the soap. The bath mitt, you'll see that when you come. It's just a good way to fold it so you don't accidentally whip it with a corner of the washcloth and cause them basically some pain. Perineal care during the bath, of course, is essential. We'll be talking about that when you come, and you know, emphasizing again, washing front to back. Back to the shampoo, you know, if you've got a resident in bed that can't get out of bed, you know, the no rinse shampoo, like the no rinse soap, is probably the route to go. Or the newer item is the shower in a cap, where you simply microwave it for whatever time is called for by the product manufacturer, and it's a shower cap, and you massage the person's scalp basically through that. Now, One of the things that's becoming more and more and more prevalent is what's called the towel bath. You know, part of your orientation when you start working back at a nursing home, you may see the movie Bathing Without a Battle. And basically what that film does is present what's called the towel bath. And we'll basically demonstrate it when you come here. But it's, think of it like a giant washcloth over the person's body. And it's a bath blanket, but think of it like a giant washcloth that's warm with no rinse soap. And it's like you're massaging the person's skin through this warm, moist, huge towel or bath blanket, really, and washing the person that way. And then using, you know, separate towels, you know, for them. So what happens is during the bed bath, the person is covered through the entire thing and just nice and laid there. The shower chair, a lot of times, you know, can be hurtful to a person. The back mesh can hurt them on their back. Well, a simple soft cotton towel to protect them against that's very good. A lot of times people feel like they are falling through the middle rim, the middle seat of the shower chair. Well, just drape a few towels over the corners of it to support them a little bit better. Or put like a child's infant seat, baby seat rim inside of the inside rim of the seat of the shower chair, and that gives them a little bit more support. Shower chairs have a tendency of making the resident's feet dangle, and dangling feet over the edge are never good. Well, simply take care of that by getting a box or something like a box, putting on its side and letting the resident rest their feet on that box or trash can or upside down wash basin or something like that, so they can basically support their legs and not have them dangle. The back rub is almost an art that is almost disappeared, especially like from hospitals. But the back rub is just something nice that we can do for the resident with long strokes going up their back. Of course, you know, warm the lotion in your hand first. Don't put cold lotion on them. But just long strokes basically on their back a lot of times can be very relaxing. Oral care, we'll talk about that when you come, especially with denture care. You know, the oral care gets the plaque and gets the, you know, food particles out of the mouth, refreshes the mouth, and just makes it feel a lot better for the resident. Get out that plaque, get out that tartar. It just gives them a lot better taste in their mouth. If they have their own teeth and simply can't bend over to the sink, bring the seat to them. Get two cups, one of them with water in it, where they can brush their teeth, rinse, and then the other one spit into, and then do that a couple times with the two cups, and take care of them that way. And of course, remember to cover their shirt, cover their lady's dress, so if they do happen when they spit out, it won't spill on them. If they do have dentures, of course, you know, you're wearing gloves for oral care. Either if you're brushing their teeth or you're doing their denture care, you are basically wearing gloves to protect yourself from any bodily fluids. But denture care, of course, is cleaning the dentures. Now, be careful if you do use a paste, you use a denture toothpaste. Don't use a regular toothpaste because that's pretty abrasive. It will scratch the dentures. Use cold water on the dentures. Don't use hot water. If you do, it'll warp the dentures and change their shape. Be careful, of course, you don't drop them and break them. But basically, doing the denture care takes just a few seconds. Then, if the resident will allow it, which is good for them, get a pink toothette and simply massage their gums. Help circulation of the gums, basically there. Everybody needs oral care, you know, after meals and bedtime. Residents that are in comas need oral care every 2 hours with the pink toothette or the green toothette. I think the pink is peppermint. I think the green is spearmint or a lemon glycerin swab. They need that every 2 hours if they're in a coma. Other grooming that we do for folks is shaving. Now, I gotta admit, my favorite is electrical razor. I do not prefer the straight razors, but a lot of times the people don't have electric razor and you've got to use a straight razor. Well, the best time to shave somebody is right after the shower, right after the bath, when the beard is moist. Shave downward on the face and shave upward basically on the neck. Nail care. I'm totally in favor of filing nails. I'm not in favor of clipping nails at all. Basically, CNAs do not clip the nails of a diabetic or anybody who's on a circulatory med. Well, face it, most of the people in our long-term care facilities fall into one of those two categories. So filing the nails takes a little bit more time, a few seconds really, but it's a lot safer to basically file them, clean underneath the cuticles, you know, keep the nails basically clean. Hair care, of course, is important for the residents. You know, it is how they look, how they feel about themselves. when you're dressing a resident, if they do have an injured arm, you know, and you're putting on a shirt like this or over the head shirt, put the arm that is injured, put that in the sleeve first when you're dressing them. And of course, don't call it good arm, bad arm, but injured or hurt arm is okay. But put that sleeve basically in first. And then when you're taking the shirt off of them, just reverse the procedure. Take it off the non-injured arm first, slip it around, and then take it off the injured arm. Vital signs and measurements. Now, you will most of the time weigh most of your residents once a month. There are some residents that you'll weigh more than that. Okay, if you're weighing a resident once a week, it's probably because they're on a special diet to gain weight or lose weight. If you're weighing a resident once a day, it's probably because they have congestive heart failure and have a tendency of water retention. So you're watching them basically for that. We get the height off a resident usually once in admission. Now, the vital signs that you get are blood pressure, temp, pulse, and respirations. The blood pressure, of course, you see different types of machines. This is the one where, of course, you've got to pump up. Most of your nursing homes are going to have something like this, which is an electronic blood pressure cuff. Because see, when you get a blood pressure, you remember you get two numbers, a top number and a bottom number. The top number is called systolic, the bottom number is called diastolic. What the top number tells you is how hard the heart has to work to pump blood. The bottom number tells you how much of a rest period the heart gets in between every heartbeat. So, first of all, you have to check to find out where the brachial artery is at. Okay, because, you know, that's going to be important, because what the brachial artery does is to tell you where do you put the bell of the stethoscope. And you put the bell of the stethoscope right over the brachial artery. Or in the case of this electronic blood pressure cuff here, when you put it on, you want this cord running right over the top of the brachial artery. And then when you do that, you know that you've basically got it positioned right. Now, me doing this myself is not going to be really totally accurate, but one thing about the blood pressure cuff that, you know, these type here, that is really good, of course, is that it basically is automatic, and when you start it up, the pump will basically inflate the cuff all by itself, and at this time you can basically be counting the person's respirations, or you can be checking the person's temperature. So this one was set to go to about 180, and then it'll basically start going down. Now, for your resident, you want them resting their arm, preferably palm up on a table or something like that, because if they're holding their arm up like that, this is work. And that work will basically raise their pressure up. And you want their palm up so it basically holds basically a lot better. Now, in this case here, this cuff is just about done. It basically told me I was 143 over 95, which is a little bit high, because basically when you take a blood pressure, for the most part, you want the top number to fall between 100 and 140. So at 143, I'm a little bit high. You want the bottom number to fall between 60 and 90. So at 95, I'm a little bit high, okay? So of course, as those numbers go higher, what that basically means is hypertension. The person basically has high blood pressure. So you want to be accurate with the pressure. If you're taking it basically with the stethoscope and a manometer and the pump style blood pressure cuff, which again, this is what we're going to be practicing on when you come for your 5-hour lab. You want to have a quiet environment. You want to make sure that, you know, the person is resting their arm down. And, you know, taking it over a single shirt sleeve like this is okay, but you don't want it bulked up with a lot of clothes here, because that'll give you a false reading. Now, most of your places are going to use an ear thermometer, a tympanic thermometer like this, and they work so fast, they work so simple. Just be sure you talk before you touch. Tell your resident you're going to be sticking something in their ear. They'll have inside here a probe cover box, which has basically the different covers in that just fit right over the probe. You'll use it once. Now, the thermometer that we have, it has a touch right here. You just touch it, it makes that part on top go green, so that means the thermometer's coming on. Now, I don't know if you can see it here, but on the LED screen, it has a couple dashes and then F. Once you get that, you're set to go. You put the probe in the ear. Now, truly for the adult, and I can't quite do this, but you really want to pull lightly, very lightly on the ear, upward and backward. That gets it to fit in there a little bit straighter. This little, what color is it? Blue button here on top. You simply push that down for just a second and it beeps, and then it tells you the person's temp. In my case, it's 98.8. Now, this has an ejector button, and I'm basically going to depress it and just let it shoot off. So you can basically see it go off, but you press it like that and it just shoots it off. So you aim it toward the trash can and just shoot it right in there. And then, of course, to conserve your battery, you want to hit this on-off button again, turn off your thermometer, and basically replace it to the holder. Now, the person's temp, we basically want to run, you know, 98.6 is our normal temp. So a degree less than that or a degree higher than that is our normal range of temps. So 97.6 to 99.6. Now, as far as pulse, when we take the pulse, we're taking that most of the time in the radial artery. This is the radial bone, and just you feel where the radial bone is, and just barely slip down a fraction of an inch down the bone. You'll feel an indentation, and in that indentation is where the radial artery is at.